because we need an answer for this thing happening. That is, if you throw an object, the object is always going to fall down, not fall to the sides or upward, right? So we found that answer. But afterwards, we got new observations. For example, it was this guy put in an object and observing the shadow of the object, and went day in the year, and there was no shadow, and put the same object in a different part of the world, and he found that that day, the object got a shadow. So it's impossible that the Earth is flat. We found an observation. We need a new paradigm. We need to make a shift, right? So what happened with Agile? So we tried to manage projects, and we thought that plans, documents, contracts, processes, and tools were the most important things when being successful on delivering software. But although we made a lot of effort on making better plans, better processes, better contracts, more documents, we couldn't be able to be successful in every project. We couldn't be repeatable on projects. So we got some observations that prove that those answers weren't true anymore. So we need a shift. We need to change our minds. And what we found out is that responding to change is very important, because change is the rule. We will always change. So making plans is important, but more important to create the capability of responding to change. On the other side, we realize that it's very important to make working products, right? Because it's the thing that we are delivering to our customers, not documents. We also understood that the only way to create great things is with great people, not with great processes. And we also learned that contracts might be a very good way to stop collaborating in organizations. And we have two kinds of contracts. This basic contract that we write with our providers, our vendors, and implicit, the one that we write within our organization with between different departments, right? And prevent us from collaborating, right? So we learned that, and we now started working in this paradigm shift, right? Who's here working in this paradigm shift, wanting this to happen? I hope all of us, right? Otherwise you can leave the room, right? This is an Agile conference, we want to make this happen, right? Furthermore, this is the Agile organization. This is what we want to build in a holistic approach in the whole organization. We want to build the right things. We want to build the things right. We want to create a conversation with the customer through the continuous delivery of products. And we want that system to be sustained in the time and continuously improving, so being faster every time, right? We all agree? Is this Agile? Great, we're working on this, we're getting this done. And what happens when you go to an organization and you explain them about Agile, you explain them about this paradigm shift, you explain them about these new kind of organizations? The first thing is that we usually start talking to the IT people, but this is a business approach. It's not an IT approach. So wrong people, guys. So we usually start talking to the wrong people, because in order to do Agile, we need the whole organization to be involved in it, because it's a paradigm shift in the product development. We need to involve everybody. In some places, this is very difficult, right? This is very difficult. And what other thing happens? This. Every time that you go to a new place with a new idea, it's like, oh, this is impossible. We can do that here. Here, you can't do that. Or we are already doing that, right? Because it's a way of saving energy. The brain is a machine created to save energy, right? If I'm already doing it, I don't need to change anything. This is if it's impossible to do it here, I don't need to change anything either. So I'm happy again. I don't need to waste my energy, right? So who has ever felt like this? is normal. We're human beings. I'm a human being too, right? And I don't like wasting my energy. I'm thinking and learning new things. And of course, telling myself that I don't know something. I know everything. I don't need to learn anything. I'm an adult. What? Okay. So now let's talk about customer centricity. So what is customer centricity? Of course, you already know what is this about. Or you are already doing it, for sure. Sorry? Yeah, well, that's right. So customer centricity is about putting your customer in the center of your business strategy, right? It's pretty intuitive, right? As Agile is pretty intuitive to understand and very difficult to do. First of all, because we need to understand that this involves the whole process of a customer or a relationship that you have with the customer. And you have a relationship with the customer when he's not your customer yet, while he's your customer, and when he's not your customer anymore, right? And you, of course, you don't know each and every one of your customers, right? So we include a lot of our uncertainty here. And human beings, we don't like uncertainty, right? So here's the question. Do you know who your customer is? Who your customer? You can say. Yeah. So very often when I ask people who's your customer, they say, it's a business guy. It's the people business. Well, this is not working the best way. It's the business guy. Maybe it's an external company that is hiring my services. Right? But it's very difficult to identify that customer. So for me, the customer is not the person who got budget to build the product. This is the person that you have to delight. So that person that got the budget for the project is just part of the team. He's just part of the common goal that is delighting someone. So the actual customer and the people that you are working for is that person that you have to create a delightful experience for, right? And you don't want to delight your business department, do you? Okay. Are you focused on delighting your boss or the of executives in your company, or maybe yourselves? So yeah, I want you to explore that. So when you build software, who are you trying to delight? The users. But the user is not always your customer. Maybe you're building an application for a call center. You're building an application to a call center. It's very difficult to identify who is your customer. So this includes a lot of uncertainty in our product. And that's why we decide to appoint someone that we are going to delight. So it's much more simple to solve that problem. I have to delight that person that represents the customer. Right? It's great. You're done. Okay, so sadly, if we want to be customer centric, we need to identify that real customer, so the person that we have to delight. And that customer, it's much more complex than that to understand. It's like a god. It's just a matter of faith, because I can meet that business person, right? I can meet him, I know his name, I know about him. But what about your customer? Maybe you have thousands of them. Maybe you don't have any. You don't know. Or maybe you have one customer today that is not your customer tomorrow, right? So dealing with customers nowadays, or dealing with customers in a company, is just like dealing with faith, dealing with a God. You just can base your approach in guesses. Just can guess what he wants, what he likes. How can he be delighted, right? So this is the real customer. This is the real customer. And The problem there is we've been taught to delight that internal customer, that person that is paying for this budget, and he's not paying. He's not even sustaining the business. Yeah? He's not even paying for the business services, right? He's not sustaining, economically sustaining the business. But instead, he's appointed to make those decisions, right? So we are focused on delighting him. But now, with this consumer-centric approach, he's just part of the team. He's just there to help us understanding the needs of the real customer. And now I know what you're thinking. We can't do that. We can't do that. Or we are already doing that. Okay. Maybe. Or maybe not. But let's explore further. So we now have this customer that we have to understand more about him, because we need that empathy to create a delightful experience for him. We need to understand more about him, right? We need to know him. So, do you know who, sorry, you know how is your customer like? Maybe you have heard about the millennials, right? We're now millennials. We don't have a lot of patience, right? We want things for yesterday. We want things to change very often. We change our minds like every 15 seconds, right? It was like 3 years ago when we all uses SMS to communicate. Now who uses SMS? Nobody. Just you. Maybe some people in the US, some people in Canada use SMS, yeah. What about netbooks? Remember netbooks, those cozy computers? Yeah, they were a feature. Now who uses those? So we just can guess. We just can guess about the customer, because we are millennials. So have you ever guessed why business is constantly changing their opinions? Because they don't know what the customer needs. We don't know either, and even the customer, they don't know what they want. It's our duty, not our duty IT people, our duty in the organizations to help the customer getting what he wants, getting what is delighting him, right? It's us to help the customer being delighted. And this is very difficult to achieve. So this is the millennials. So this is my customer. Like Homer Simpson, so he wants everything. Remember this episode from Simpsons? Who remembers? Okay. So in this episode, Homer Simpson's lost brother, he has a big car manufacturing company, right? And he appoints his brother Homer Simpson to design a new car, the car of future, the car that delights the normal family man in the US. And this is what delights Homer Simpson. But maybe it's not what he needs. So I think that it's our duty as engineers, as product owners, as salespeople, as marketing guys, is our duty to help him understanding his needs and delighting in them, right? It's our duty. So now we have new questions in this paradigm shift, right? So now, what kind of experience is our product creating? Because, sorry guys, we don't deliver software. We are not as important as we think. We are delivering experience. Experiences is what people want, right? I don't want an application to control my finances in a bank. I want to control my finances in a bank. Now I have to do it with an application in my mobile phone, but tomorrow I won't. And I'd rather not need to do that, right? Rather have someone to do that for me, right? So, it's about delivering experiences. then we have to understand more about how is my customer like. We need to empathize with him. Furthermore, because it's very difficult to delight everyone, right? And we need to understand what is, how is our strategy like. So do we want to create this wow moment, like, oh, this is incredible, this is great, or we want to be wow in the basics and do the basics very, very good, because doing both is very difficult, right? But two different approach, business approaches, right? We have to choose, and choosing is very difficult. But for that, we only have a way to accomplish that. So create a conversation with the customer. So we don't know, they don't know, we have to collaborate with the actual customer outside of our organization. This is very difficult to do. And the only way to collaborate with someone is through a conversation. We have to talk to him, right? We have to talk to him through the continuous delivery of experiences. Maybe supported by software, maybe not. But we have to understand from the customer. We have to create this feedback loop, this listen, understand what he wants, and then respond. And then listen together what happened. You like it, you don't like it, right? So here, I can underline that this is an advantage for us, that we want to do Agile, because we all here want to do Agile, true? Okay. Because I can have a conversation with someone this way. So here you have the software. So hello, how are you? And when he starts answering me, he's saying, well, I'm okay, then I leave. He said, no, I will build somewhere for you, I will be your next answer, right? Providing then, I think that you have a broken leg, so I will bring you a wheelchair. So then after 3 years, I do a wheelchair, and I go there, and he told me, it's okay, I don't need that. Right? No, it took me 3 years to build you a proper wheelchair, because I saw you got a broken leg. Yeah, but I got a broken leg 3 years ago, right? I got a netbook 3 years ago, right? Can you imagine that? Can you imagine building an application, so getting the budget for an application specifically for a netbook and delivering that application right now? Doesn't make any sense, right? So the only way to conversation with a customer is through the continuous delivery of software. So we have to deliver often. And the only way to deliver often is doing short iteration. This is like, yeah, this is great for us. Right? It makes sense. Finally, it makes sense. So this is about the build, measure, learn cycle. So do you all know this? What is this about? Right? Who knows this cycle? Okay, so this is a lean startup, right? So this is the product development through experimentation. Yes, I don't know what the customer wants, so I create an hypothesis, and then I build something, get feedback from that something, and then continue in the same track or change direction, right? So this is why it's now becoming very popular, this lean startup movement, because it's actually helpful to create a conversation with the actual customer. So it makes sense. So why do we fail involving business in our agile initiatives? Why? Because it's not meaningful for them. It is an IT thing, right? We go there and say, hey, we have the answer. We have the answer. We now know how to deliver software faster. And what are they thinking? They are thinking this. This is the user story. So as an internal customer, I want you, IT, to build the product that I sold to my boss, right? So that I can look good in the next meeting, right? I will delight my boss. This is the user story that I have in my mind. So, and a very interesting thing about user story is that the product owner doesn't need to know how is that going to be built, right? actually, they don't care about how you're going to do this. How are you going to do Agile? This is my user story, okay? I'm the internal customer, so do this Agile thing for me. I don't know, and I don't care how, right? So I think we have to break this in order to be successful involved in the business in our Agile initiatives, because we need them, okay? We already agree on that. We need business involved in this. Agile is not an IT movement. It's a business approach, right? So now, with this approach, with this concept of involving the final customer in your conversation, involving the final customer in the business, and being focused on creating a delightful experience for him, we can be meaningful for the business. We can be part of that together. We got a common goal. So now, as a company, our role, so IT and business, is to deliver delightful experience so that being one of our customers is freaking great. This is a purpose. This is a common goal, and we can achieve that goal together with the business. Then, business will join you in this transition, in these agile implementations. You will get your product owner seated close to the developers. That's what we want, it's what we need, right? But software for them is just a tool, right? What we do, blaming them for not coming. No. There's business guys, they don't care about the software. Of course, because software is just a tool to deliver experiences for a customer. You're not so important. So ask them for help to delight your customer together. And then they will join you, I promise, right? So the good thing is that Agile is a great way to do this, right? We know that in Agile it's very important to collaborate, to work in multidisciplinary teams, to work in small incrementations, continuously delivering, focus on quality, collaboration, communication. So Agile is a great way to do this thing, to work together towards this common goal of delighting your customer. So we're lucky. Otherwise, we should need to create a new paradigm and a new shift. So maybe the shift is just a help for us, right? Instead of an impediment. So, customer-centric Agile 101. So how can we start putting the customer on the center of our organization when doing Agile? So those are my tips. First of all, include actual customers in your inception process. So who is here doing inceptions? Oh my God, we should all be doing inceptions. So how can you prepare for a project? We need to do some inception to understand what you're going to build, right? Okay, so who is the one who are you delighting? The final customer. Invite them to come. You need the insights. You need them. Next, who here is using personas? Okay, who knows the technique? Okay, so this is a technique that we use to create empathy for the final customer, right? So we depict an actual customer with needs, age, name, personal situation, how he behaves as a customer with how he interacts with our company. So I encourage you to include, for example, so of course use this tool, but include the moments of truth, right? There are the moments in the life of a customer that interact with your business, right? They're not so important. If, for example, you work for a bank, the customer is not the whole day expecting the great moment of opening your applications to make money wiring. No, it's not that important in his life, If you work for a video game company, the customer is not the whole day like looking forward to play that game that you built. No. That happens in a moment in his life. So he's doing his thing, one part of the way he decided to start playing, maybe the bathroom, right? Or he decided to do that money learning. I mean, he doesn't want to do it. And we have to take that into account. He's doing something that he doesn't want to do. So we have to understand that before creating the experience, because we are working on an experience. So that's why I encourage you to include this moment of truth. So when is this customer having a contact with your business, and what is the touch point? So what is the instrument that we use to contact that customer, right? Because it's the handle that we're going to use to create that experience, right? More things. So if you use user story mapping, if you use just epics, connect your customer journey to those epics. So who here is using customer journey or knows the customer journey too? Not many? Okay. So this is just depending on that situation that I talk about. So you have the customer, you have the life of your customer, this is the day, a day in the life of the customer, and here, in this precise moment, when this happened, he uses our application. So then we can connect that moment in his life with the usage of our application. It's very important, because you're not gonna behave the same if you have to do if you're gonna play a video game when you are in the bathroom or when you are drunk with your friends, because the experience is much more different, and you have to delight that customer in a different way, right? So connect the journey of your customer to your epics or to your user story maps, right? So you will get more empathy for your customer. You will learn more for the context of the customer. Something else that you can do. At epic level, you have to have conversations about your customer, not about your user, because not always your customer is your user. We were the first talking about the call center example, right? So if you're building an application for a call center, who are you to delight? The call center operator or the person calling the bank? Maybe both, but for sure one is not negotiable. The person who is sustaining the business, right? But both is a great answer. So I have here a tip that I find useful, because I think the user stories are not very intuitive to do this, right? Because they focus a lot on the user and on things that are very detailed, very into details, right? They're not so focused on the experiences. So for that, I will use a different stuff. Let's make an example. So for example, there, as a call center operator, I want to search in the ATM location list so I can tell the customer the closest working ATM. That's a normal user story, right? We'll understand that. But the problem though is that that doesn't lead to any innovation. It's done, right? The only way to satisfy my customer there is through the delivery of a location of an ATM, right? So let's see what happens if we include more empathy for the customer in the initial conversation and an epic level. Something like this can happen. So let's talk about Margaret. Margaret is one of our customers, and he needs cash to pay at the restaurant, right? Let's say she lost her credit card, right? No, sorry, the ATM doesn't work there. Let's say the device in the restaurant doesn't work anymore, for example, right? The device doesn't work anymore. So the touch point there is the call of the operator. She calls. Margaret calls the operator. And then Margaret, that can't find a working ATM, wants to withdraw some money to pay the restaurant. But when she calls the call center, the operator wires the money directly to the restaurant and finds the nearest ATM for Margaret based on her location. That's wow. Can you imagine that? So you call and say, I can't pay here. Oh, no worries, it's already paid. We took the money from your bank account. Here you have an ATM. Oh, great, thanks. That would be a very delightful experience. It's already paid. Oh, wow. No, the customer. You're the customer calling the operator, right? And the operator, of course, she asks you, no, I can directly pay for you. This is an innovation, right? Maybe it's not the way to go, but it's just a different way to delight the customer. We are thinking in a different way. We're using this lateral thinking. We're creating alternatives. This is innovation, right? So why can we create this innovation if we talk about that level? Because we create empathy for the customer before. So we create a situation, we create a journey for that customer. This is the customer, this is the situation, here's the touch point. Here he communicates with someone, that someone is using the software. So now I have to design the software in order to delight Margaret, provided that situation for Margaret. And that's a nice purpose, right? Make you feel good. Margaret now feels better. We created a nice experience for Margaret. Right? So I encourage you to work this way. So this is not a template, right? Disclaimer is just a reminder. I think a nice way to talk about customers at epic level is this way. Creating that persona, right? Really understand if he needs to do that, if he would like to do that, if he wants it, or if he's asked to. For example, I'm asked to introduce my login ID and password. I don't want to, I need to. So that way I can start identifying things that our customer doesn't want to do, and we're forcing him. So maybe we need an alternative, right? With a user story, everything is correct. With this, not everything is correct. If the customer wants something, it's great that we give that something to him. But if he needs or is asked to do something that he doesn't want, it's not a good thing to do. Maybe we need an alternative. So I think that at an epic level, we need to explore further to create better experiences. More things that we can do. We can include actual customers in our reviews, right? If you're doing Scrum, why don't you invite some customers to the demos? If you are releases, why don't you invite actual customers to our releases? You can get great feedback from them, right? Some banks, they do that. They even pay the customer to see how they behave when they're shown the new application, right? It's a good way to understand more about your customer. So then I encourage you to start using real feedback to establish your priorities, to prioritize your backlog. And real feedback is the only feedback that you get from your real customer. For example, this is a website from a bank in Spain that I used to work for, ING, where there's a public website where people can prioritize the backlog for the next releases on the product. So it's not that you're getting that priorities because you can maybe build something like Homer Simpson wanted, but you can use that feedback because it's real feedback. Now we have social media that is a great tool to understand more about your customer. So we can use the stars in the market, in the Apple market, in the Android market, or you can use Facebook, Twitter, whatever, to understand about your customer and get real feedback. And for that, you need to deliver often, right? Useful is if you deliver something now and you get the feedback from your customer in the old social network for 3 years and then you react. You have to do it often. And the business will join you doing this. The business will love this approach because they will feel frustrated when they get some feedback in social media and they can't do anything about it. That's why they put pressure on us. They put pressure on IT because they feel frustrated. So let's work together on delivering software faster and answering to those needs faster. For that, we need to create a customer-centric culture. So it has to be embedded in the DNA of the organizations in order to focus on the real customer. So you have to be really careful on what you measure, because you can get it. And if you measure people for the number of user stories they deliver, you will get user story. Nothing else. If you measure people for the success of their marketing campaigns, you're going to get successful marketing campaigns. Awesome advertisement. But if you need to delight customer, measure how delighted your customers are. Not at all. And that is difficult, because it's very, very difficult to measure. What else? So, of course, if we are to delight that customer, we can't be divided in silos, right? Because we will have different goals. And we are now in a common goal, so create that freaking awesome experience of being our customer. So maybe we have to change our structures. And not anymore being organized like IT, marketing, sales, but instead just in trucks. In trucks that are oriented to delight the customers. So maybe we have to change the way we organize. Right? There are some organizations that already work that way. I know another bank that works this way. But it is organized towards moment in the life of the customers. That is a very good way to focus on that, on the customer, not on the practice. The practice is just one thing that we have to do in order to deliver that experience. So we know in Agile that it's a bad idea to have a team just with DBAs, another team with front-end developers, and our team just back with back-end developers, but we're doing the same stuff on a higher level. We have IT, they don't talk to the business. We have legal people, weird guys, we have marketing guys, always asking for people. We're doing the same mistake, but a different level. So if this paradigm shift involves changing how we organize on a realistic level. So now I have to insert yours here, right? There are many things that you can do to create that customer-centric culture in your organization. Of course, you can't do that just yourself. You have to include the business here. You have to include all the organization here into create that culture. And you're going to take time and blah, 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 and all those things that you have been told when you started doing Agile. Because it's more or less the same, but this time it's more complicated. You have to involve more people, right? So I recommend you to use what you already know, right? And you have the Agile community, a lot of knowledge that can help us focusing on the customers. So for example, here I have some of the things that helped me understanding about this. One is this book, Lean Startup, and I learned about how to understand projects as hypothesis, just as a way to learn from the customer, right? So another very interesting concept that helped me a lot creating that empathy for the environment of my customer is design thinking. That is, who here knows about design thinking? Great. It's a process and a set of tools that help people creating empathy for the customer, right? We observe the customer, then we generate ideas based on those observations, and then we prototype and iterate. Sounds familiar? Great. So, let's learn from Agile. Thankfully, this is not this customer centricity way of working. It's not an impediment for Agile, but the other way around. the Agile way of thinking is a good way to be customer-centric, because it encourages us to focus on actual products, to collaborate, cooperate, communicate, and create good people that work towards great goals, right? So maybe if you don't feel like going impulse or encourage your organization to start being customer-centric, use this to encourage business people to join you in the Agile movement, because it's a first step. First step for the organization to become customer-centric, and first step for the business people to be part of the Agile movement, and first step for you for not being alone on this transformation, this shift. So, now again, I know that you're thinking this. Why are we doing that? Well, we can't do that in the organization. After this almost 45 minutes talking about customer centricity, I don't think you are already thinking this way. If you are, please come. We can discuss about this. Right? Come to me after the talk and we can discuss about this. Because I think that it's a shift that has to happen. I haven't seen many organizations working this way. And on the other side, I think it's possible. I think we can do this. It's not easy. But I think it's the way to go to create more happy customers and more purposeful organizations. Because everything is about purpose. This purpose will be our motivation, right? It's not very motivating trying to delight this guy in the business, but it's very motivating to create great experience for other people, to help other people. Everybody loves that. So, how can I make this happen in my organization? Here I have the clue, the thing that you have been waiting for all these years. So how can you create this change, and any change in your organizations? Are you ready? This is the way. So you have to pray and say, God, grant me the serenity to accept the things that I cannot change, the courage to change the thing that I can change, and the wisdom to understand the difference. So of course these changes are not gonna happen overnight, right? They're gonna happen step by step, right? So you have to change or try to make change happen step by step. We will get there. We will get that, not tomorrow, not in 1 year, not in 2 years. But what we enjoy is not the goal, it's not being there, but walking through there. Walking through there is the enjoyable thing. So let's start walking through there and let's make it happen. So that's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Angel.
Any questions?
Great. Of course. We can take a couple of questions. All right.
You specified that the internal customer is basically the person who is dedicated or marked to communicate the needs of the actual users. Mm-hmm. But what if it's actually an internal project? Then you're actually, your customers are within a reach.
Who are you trying to delight?
The same people in our office.
So give me an example.
Example from the current place I work. There is this tool that people in company use and we're maintaining it.
Mm-hmm.
So from this perspective, our customers are the ones who are actually using it.
Mm-hmm. You're talking now about technical user stories.
From a
different perspective, right? You're talking about something that you're working on that is not going to deliver an actual value to the product, but is going to be good for the building of the product, like in like a technical user story, right?
Okay. It's like we'll take it afterwards.
No, I just don't understand. I just don't understand because there are many projects, like finance thing, for example, right? Or systems that we use to connect other systems, or data mining system, or whatever. Whatever we build in organizations are to be focused on delighting a customer at the end. And if it's difficult to create that connection, maybe we have to think if there is a way to connect that to with a delightful experience with our customer, or whether or not it's worth it to invest on that or not, right? Because we also have to balance how much effort are we paying on products that just delight our internal people or that delight our actual customers. Does that answer your question?
We'll continue afterwards.
Let's okay.
All right, so one more question, then we take a short break.
I don't believe you because this thing raises a lot of questions, right? So just after, you can ask me whatever you want. I would love to answer you.
All right, so my question, you mentioned on one of your slides that the culture is the key factor.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you practically change the culture?
Wow.
What do you do?
This is another talk.
One advice. Thank you.
This is a real talk, but I said last year, right, that if you want to change a culture, start changing yourself and see what happened.
Thanks.
Yeah, welcome.